Good to see you all this morning. No children's church. Wow. I'm still reeling from last week. You know, after I posted my sermon last week, I had a pastor from South Carolina, Joseph Chandler, and he began enlightening me about the Hebrew calendar. You know, I heard something about it before, but when I studied last week about the 3 days Jesus was in the grave, I didn't see any of it in my commentaries. So I worked under the assumption that Jesus was taken down on the cross on Friday, the day before the weekly Sabbath. And I worked up the conclusion that Jesus may not have been fully resurrected when he was out of the grave on Sunday morning until he presented himself to the disciples that evening. And I also came to the conclusion that Jesus may have died spiritually when he took our sins before he died physically on the cross. Anyways, this is the Sunday after Easter, and all the CEOs are gone. Okay? Christmas, Easter only people. A pastor on Easter Sunday, they don't want to lay an egg, and I did. I laid an egg on Easter Sunday. I could have done better. I could have looked. I could have seen that there's something more in the Hebrew calendar that explains the 3 days and three nights that Jesus was in the heart of the earth. I have a very limited grasp on this Bible. And every time I look at it and I see it, I go, whoa, look at all this stuff that's in there. And I sometimes I can grasp a little bit at a time, and I share that with you. But I hope that my conclusions and my observations pale in comparison to the words that are written and read off this page, off these pages in this Bible. That's the truth. Not what comes out of my mouth. I'm just doing the best I can to make an application and proclaim what God wants to proclaim. But his word is the one that's truth, not my limited observations. And I want you to understand that. So let's turn to Luke 23:52. Traditions can blind us to the way the Hebrew ceremonies and feasts were fulfilled in the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus. And Joseph sent me some explanations that there was another Sabbath involved, particularly on this slide. My first reaction was, well, this is the internet, you know. It can be true, right? False and fake news, whatever. But I asked him for more verification and trusted sources like the Bible or maybe some manuscripts that were predated Christ. And I have to admit that I was a little proud of my study and my observations and the conclusions of my explanations of last week's Sunday sermon. I was a little proud that I'd preached to a record crowd of 85 people. And Friday, Good Friday, we had over 100 people in here. I mean, it was a great week. And now, this Joseph guy from South Carolina says, hey, it wasn't Friday. It was probably Wednesday that Jesus Christ was crucified. And through everything, this new revelation, it totally threw everything that I'd said. Well, not everything, but it reconciled the 3 days and the three nights that Jesus was supposed to be placed in the tomb. And I missed it. You know, I got to say, though, I can make a slide that pronounces Thursday as the day that Jesus was put in the tomb, and that was the real Sabbath that was before when they had to put him in there. I could make a slide like that. Just a slide doesn't make it true. In the same token, just because On Good Friday, people have been celebrating Jesus' death or observing Jesus' death for thousands of years, almost 2,000 years. And many biblical scholars back it up. And we had 100 people here on Friday and 85 people on Sunday. Doesn't make that true either. What makes it true? What makes it true? The Bible. The truth is in the Bible. In Luke 23:52, going to Pilate, he asked for Jesus' body. And then he took it down, wrapped it in linen cloth, and placed it in a tomb cut in a rock, one which no one had yet been laid. It was preparation day, and the Sabbath was about to begin. Please underline that or make a mental note. It was preparation day, and the Sabbath was about to begin. The woman who had come with Jesus from Galilee followed Joseph and saw the tomb and how his body was laid in it. Then they went home and prepared spices and perfumes, but they rested on the Sabbath in obedience to the commandment. So there's a little bit of a blank in there, okay? They put Jesus in the tomb on the Sabbath. They observed Jesus in the tomb. Then they went and prepared spices, which was against the rules and regulations of the Sabbath. That was working. And then they observed the Sabbath in obedience to the commandment. So there's a hint that there's a gap in there. There's another non-Sabbath day in between the Sabbath and the Sabbath. Just keep that in your mind. Let's turn to Leviticus 23:1. From Restoring of the Way Ministry, also an internet source, many scholars have read this in Luke 23:54 and have come to the wrong conclusion that this meant the weekly Sabbath. So Jesus had to have been crucified on Friday. After all, that's where we get the term Good Friday, from which is the Friday before Easter Sunday, when supposedly Jesus rose from the grave. The only problem with this conclusion is that Yeshua declared a sign of his authenticity as the Messiah that he would be in the grave just as Jonah was in the belly of a fish for 3 days and three nights. That's the end of the quote. Does anybody remember this slide last week? Okay? I was under the conclusion that this was debunking the resurrection of Christ. It was taking the Bible and saying, okay, it says 3 days and three nights. Jesus was only in the grave from Friday to Sunday, which is about 40 hours, which doesn't even make 2 days, and they're claiming it's 3 days. But actually, this thing was all underneath my nose the whole time. It explains, and I can't even read the words up there, and it's more than we got time for today, but explains that the evening, the 12 hours and 72 hours that Jesus could have been in the grave. And according to biblical evidence, okay? So it was right underneath my nose. Now I've understood where a Sabbath can be the seventh day of the week. I've also understood where a Sabbath can be a whole year, the seventh year. And I told Joseph, I said, but I've never seen or saw where a Sabbath day could be another day of the week. You know, like Monday, Tuesday, or Wednesday. I've never realized that from Scripture. So rather than prove the Sabbath idea from the internet or some slide, we're going to go to the Old Testament to make just a few observations. And as we read through Leviticus 23, please underline and make note of each time the Sabbath was written. Okay? Leviticus 23, starting with verse 1. And the Lord said to Moses, speak to the Israelites and say to them, these are my appointed feasts and the appointed feast of the Lord, which you are to proclaim as sacred assemblies. There are 6 days you may work, but the seventh day is a Sabbath of rest, a day of sacred assembly. You are not to do any work, whether you live, wherever you live. It is a Sabbath. Okay, underline those two Sabbaths to the Lord. Okay, these Sabbaths spoken of in verse 3 are the weekly Sabbath. They are the Sabbath of seventh day of the week, Saturday. Okay, they fall after Friday. Okay, now we're going to go to verse 4. These are the Lord's appointed feasts. We're going to talk about feasts now. The sacred assemblies you are proclaim at their appointed times. The Lord's Passover begins at twilight on the 14th day of the first month. On the 15th day of that month, the Lord's Feast of Unleavened Bread begins. For 7 days, you must eat bread made without yeast. Okay, before I go on, I want to explain how the first month of the year works. Okay? They don't go according to our Gregorian calendar, where every year starts on New Year's Eve, January 1st. They go according to the moon. And when that moon first shines after the new moon, as soon as that sliver shows, that is the first day of that month. Okay? The first month of the year is not January. It is the springtime. It's called Aviv. Okay? Anybody know what Aviv is? Okay? Aviv is when the wheat heads out and it starts changing color. Okay? That's when the wheat can be destroyed by hail. Okay? Or barley. Specifically barley. Barley is the crop that they start the Aviv on. Okay? When the Egyptians were going through all those plagues and the great hail came down, the barley was destroyed because it was in the Aviv state. The wheat and the spelt were still okay because they were still green. So during the Passover time, that was the time of the barley. Okay? If for some reason, the 12th month, at the end of the 12th month, the moon shows clear and the barley is not in the Aviv state yet, it's still green, they'll have a 13th month. That's their leap year on the Jewish calendar. A whole month. Can you imagine being born on the 13th month? I mean, they have a birthday every 20 years. You know, crazy, huh? Okay, so maybe some parents particularly try to have kids during that month so they'd only have to buy birthday presents for their kids. Whatever. But that's how the calendar works. I mean, even in the seventh month or the sixth month or the fifth month, their month does not start until that first sliver of the moon shows. And especially in the Eastern Mideast, sometimes there's a discrepancy. That moon, you can't predict it. It could be 2 days after the moon first disappears until the first of the month starts. It could be 3.5 days. So they don't know when that month is going to start. So they don't get their calendars and say, okay, Monday, the first of the month is going to be on a Monday or a Tuesday. They don't know until that moon shows. Isn't that crazy? Well, that's how the Hebrew calendar works. Okay, so anyways, obviously harvest time comes much earlier in the Hebrew thing. But here's the Aviv calendar, and you got a picture of it in your insert. You can't probably barely read any of the numbers besides the 1-2. But if you look on this calendar, this is this year, 2017. This is what their calendar looks like, 2017. The full moon the new moon started on the March 30th. Okay? On April 13th is their Aviv 15. And that's the Feast of Unleavened Bread. The Passover, the day of preparation, is April the 12th. Their 14th, the 14th of Aviv. And then we're going to read a little bit right now about what those days are. So if you look at that calendar, the 15th is an important day, and then we have the day of first fruits, the 18th, which is April 16th, which was our Easter Sunday. Okay. All right. Verse 6. On the 15th day of that month, the Lord's Feast of Unleavened Bread begins. For 7 days you must eat bread made without yeast. On the first day, hold a sacred assembly and do no regular work. Okay? And do no regular work. Remember that. On the verse 8, for 7 days present an offering made to the Lord by fire. and on the seventh day hold a sacred assembly and do no regular work. Okay, so on the 15th, do no regular work, and on the 21st, do no regular work. Okay, these 2 days that they were due to do no regular work would fall on Thursday and Wednesday of this year. It does not call them Sabbaths in these verses, but go down to verse 32, please. In verse 32, this is another feast. This is the Feast of Tabernacles. Okay, this is the last feast. Okay, on verse 32, it is a Sabbath of rest for you, and you must deny yourselves from the evening of the ninth day of the month until the following evening. You are to observe the Sabbath. Okay, going according to the Jewish calendar, there is another Sabbath. Okay, the ninth day of the seventh month does not always fall on the seventh day of the week. It could fall on a Monday. It could fall on a Tuesday. Okay, this is where I came to the conclusion. Okay. The Sabbath isn't always on the seventh day of the week. It isn't always the seventh year of the... There's other Sabbaths involved. And so, judging from my... Can you follow me in this area? Okay? The ninth day of the seventh month is a Sabbath. And they were to do no regular work. Okay? It doesn't call it the Sabbath on the 15th day, but it's a day you're not to do no regular work. So I've made the conclusion or an observation, at least there's a possibility that the 15th could be called the Sabbath. Okay, are you following me? I mean, it took me almost all week to start. Okay, I can do this. I can try to explain it because I can almost understand it. Okay, you guys have got to be brighter than me, so... sometimes it's nice to have somebody that's dull up here, because if I can understand it, then you can understand it. All right? That's what I figure. Okay, so now the Sabbath after the day of preparation was the Sabbath before Jesus was placed in the tomb. Okay? And we've already read that out of Luke 23:53. And as I reviewed some of the commentaries again, I said, okay, I've got to see this. Some of the commentaries got to have this in them. And I still fell on a blank note as far as on any other day being the Sabbath other than the seventh day of the week. Remember, these are still my conclusions, all right? And who knows if I may come up with something totally different next week, because I've been corrected again. But be Bereans. I loved what Cheyenne prayed this morning. May we check this out for ourselves. Okay? Don't take my word for this. Go into the Bible. Check it out for yourself. The Bible has all the answers. We just don't know all the answers quite yet. Okay, finishing up with the passage of Feast of Unleavened Bread, let's go to verse 9. The Lord said to Moses, "Speak to the Israelites and say to them, when you enter the land I'm going to give you, and you reap its harvest, bring to the priest a sheaf of the first grain you harvest. He is to wave the sheaf before the Lord, so it will be accepted on your behalf. The priest is to wave it on the day after the Sabbath." Okay? That is the seventh day of the week. That is the day they call observe on the 18th day, the day of first fruits. And that's what we observe on April 16th. He is risen! Yes! Resurrection Sunday. Please, let's turn to John 19:30. The calendar really helped me visualize and understand what I missed. Does anybody have any questions? The Old Testament is so descriptive of what Jesus would do. It amazes me that the Jewish leaders who were in on this, who watched the Sabbath and everything, didn't see this. I mean, even to the point of Paul. Palm Sunday. We still have some palms back there. But Palm Sunday was the day that, and that's the tenth, the Passover lamb was selected. This was a tradition in Jerusalem. They would select, the priest would select the Passover lamb. And they would march it down the streets of Jerusalem and bring it to the temple. Jesus, what did he do? He marched down the street. He beat them to the punch, okay? Here was everything laid out before him, Palm Sunday. And he presented himself as the perfect Lamb of God, selected on that day. They were marching to march that lamb down the streets of Jerusalem and bring it to the temple. And they were selecting that. And then during that time, the people also selected their lambs and they brought that lamb into their homes, okay? They had this little pet in their home. And the idea of that was, is that they were going to observe and test that lamb the whole time it was in their house to see if it had any blemishes. Does it have anything wrong with it? And the whole time, that's what they did with Jesus. They tested him and tested him and tested him. And then finally, Pilate says, I find no fault in this man. And then that's what they did with the Jewish ceremony. They would say, I find no fault with this lamb. And then they would sacrifice it. And when Pilate says, I find no fault with this man, the Jews says, crucify him. Isn't that crazy? Everything in this Word of God and their ceremonies. I mean, Jesus. Isn't that neat? And it excites you. And I hope it excites you the way it excites me. And I hope it excites you to be like Joseph had to share it with me. He says, I know how you preached on Sunday, and I liked how you preached, but you're missing something. I got to share it with you. It's the Hebrew calendar. It's all talking about Jesus. And if you could just see it, you know, it establishes it. It doesn't take away from the Holy Week. It establishes it. It solidifies it. It takes away any reproach. You know, Friday is not always the day before Sabbath. In the case of the burial of Jesus, the day before the Sabbath was the preparation day. It's always the preparation. And the Sabbath was about to begin that we read of in Luke 23:54. But look at John 19:30. When he had received the drink, Jesus said, it is finished. That's another thing that the priests do in the temple. They say, it's finished when the lamb is sacrificed. That's just so cool. Jesus said, it is finished. With that, he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. Now it was the day of preparation. And the next day was to be a special Sabbath. Isn't that cool? Because the Jews did not want the bodies left on the crosses during the Sabbath, they asked Pilate to have the legs broken and the bodies taken down. Please, let's turn to Colossians 2:15. You know, these treasures are awesome about the resurrection. But may we not get too sidetracked with all the information and miss what they are pointing to. Jesus Christ is risen. You know, yes, it's not wrong to observe Jesus' crucifixion on a Friday either. The cross is the center of the gospel. Okay, in Colossians 2:15, it says, and having disarmed the powers and authorities, he made a public spectacle of them, triumphing over them by the cross. Therefore, do not let anyone judge you by what you eat or drink, or with regard to a religious festival, a new moon celebration, or a Sabbath day. These are a shadow of things that were to come. The reality, however, is found in Christ. Because he is risen, we as believers are raised with him. The reality is found in Christ. Okay, let's turn to 1 Corinthians 13:2. We already read a little bit of that this morning, but we must be careful not to build up good traditions, good studies, good statements of faith. You know, we can have all the feasts down to a T, and okay, this is what happens then. This is what happens then. Isn't this cool? And have everything down and explain it in perfect ways where everybody could understand it. But if we're missing something, if we're missing the substance, the reality is Christ, then we're lost. We're losing everybody. You know, if the ceremonies and feasts were completely prophetic, okay, about Jesus' first advent, okay? Some people say the fall feast, the Feast of Tabernacles, is prophetic about his future event. Wouldn't that be cool to understand that? One of the things that Jesus says, no one knows the day or the hour when the Son of Man comes. That almost is in direct saying with what they say when that month starts. You know, when's the first of the month going to start? Well, no one knows the day or the hour because we don't know if it's going to be 2 days or 3.5 days when that month starts. So that's kind of prophetic, and it leads into that month. Okay, so, but if we could have everything connected. In 1 Corinthians 13:2, if I have the gift of prophecy and can fathom all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have faith that can move mountains, but have not love, I am nothing. Please, let's turn to 1 Peter 1:3. You know, God didn't call us to be students. He called us to make disciples. He called us to be ambassadors with a ministry of reconciliation. And if anybody doesn't believe that, read Wayne Shirt. He called us to be transformed to the image, nature, and mind of Christ. He called us to love. The reality is found in Christ. It's not what you know, but who you know and who knows you. My son Tyler, he said that 80% of the jobs that are filled in this country are not advertised. They're filled with people who know someone or someone knows them. It isn't the degrees, it isn't the experience, or even the personality that usually takes the job. It is who you know and who knows you. Knowledge, experience, and personality can play a big part, but 80% is about relationships. Okay, now that I've spent 20% of my sermon on prophecy, mysteries, and knowledge, let's take the next 80% of my sermon to dive into what really counts. I saw someone looking at the clock. I was wondering who was going to look at their watch. I caught you. Boom. Somebody's got a whiplash, I know. We... At least I know she's listening. We observe some really wonderful things about the timeline of death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus. What is the reality? What's the reality of all this? Is it in the ceremonies? Is it in this church building? What's the reality? The reality is, what'd you say?
Jesus died for us.
Jesus died. The reality is Christ. The reality is Christ. That's what Colossians said. You know, the Sabbaths, the ceremonies, the festivals, just everything. The reality is Christ. In 1 Peter 1, starting with verse 3, praise be to God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In his great mercy, he has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, and into an inheritance that can never perish, spoil, or fade, kept in heaven for you, who through faith are shielded by God's power until the coming of the salvation that is ready to be revealed in the last time. In this you greatly rejoice, for a little while you may have had to suffer grief in all kinds of trials, These have come so that your faith, of greater worth than gold, which perishes even though refined by fire, may be proved genuine and may result in praise, glory, and honor when Jesus Christ is revealed. Though you have not seen him, you love him. And even though you do not see him now, you believe in him and are filled with an inexpressible and glorious joy. For you are receiving the goal of your faith, the salvation of your souls. The reality is Christ. You know, the traditions, the knowledge, the prophecies, you know, they won't get you through the hardships and the trials and the refining of this life. Only Jesus will. You know, if you look at our lives, when we trust in Christ, okay, we become an Aviv state. All of a sudden, we start noticing some fruit. We're starting to head out. You understand what I'm saying? We trust in Christ. This is a very vulnerable state. When we trust in Christ, there will be trials. Jesus says there will be trials. Over and over, Peter says, you know, don't be surprised at the fiery ordeal you're going through as if something strange were happening to you. There's going to be some trials. And if you look at life, I mean, it almost looks like the storms are brewing and like a big hailstorm is coming. And it's going to wipe you out. That's what it looks like. Remember what the Aviv state and the barley is. We, as believers, are still in this Aviv state. It is a very vulnerable state where grief, all kinds of trials and refining can be like a great hail of the Egyptian plagues trying to destroy us. But what does verse 5 say? What does verse 5 say? Can we read it together? Who, through faith, are shielded by God's power until the coming of salvation that is ready to be revealed in the last time. We are shielded by God's power. Yes, we're vulnerable. If it was up to us, we would lose our salvation, but it's not up to us. We're shielded by God's power to get us through and to protect the fruit that is headed out in our lives. Love, joy, peace, and all that stuff. God protects us. You know, wouldn't that be great if we had that for our crops out there? You know, when we see that the thunderheads brewing and the wheat's in the Aviv state or whatever grain's in the Aviv state And then we say, "Hey, God's got it shielded." You know, we don't got to worry. That's what we have with our lives. And when Satan or the world or even our flesh throws all kinds of troubles at us and we fear, "Oh no, I'm not going to make it. I'm not going to make it. I'm not going to make it." It's not us. And it's not the storm. It's God's shielding power. That's going to get us through to the day when God presents us fully matured. Just like they did 15 days after that Aviv started. Or actually 17 days. I don't know. I don't got the calendar. What day is it? Was it 16th day? Okay, it was the 18th day. That's when the priest presented that wheat or that barley. It was barley in that temple and waved it as an offering. We will be presented whole, complete, and mature by God because he will shield us through the plagues of this life. We are shielded through faith by God's power to the time of harvest. Okay, the day after the weekly Sabbath, as we read from Leviticus 23:11, he is to wave the sheaf before the Lord, so it will be accepted on your behalf. On whose behalf? Jesus was waved, was resurrected on our behalf. The priest is to wave it on the day after the Sabbath, and that Sabbath is the weekly Sabbath, the day before our Resurrection Sunday. The reality of the sheaf of barley is who? Jesus. Jesus made it through every test and waved himself before the Lord. He rose from the dead and was accepted on whose behalf? Ours. We can rely on that truth. Let's pray. Lord God, we come to you today and we thank you for life. We thank you for your word, which is so true and protects us and guides us and opens up your love for us. Lord, help us not to be missing it like the Jews did in the day of Jesus. Lord, help us to grasp it. Help us to see that the reality is you and not the ceremonies themselves. Lord, as we go our way today, Lord, help us to be reassured over and over and over again that you are the perfect Lamb, that you did raise up from the dead, and that we will raise with you, be complete with you, as believers with you on that day. Lord, in this we greatly rejoice, and we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.